Ephesians chapter 1. I'm going to look at something this morning that I hope is going to be challenging to you. If it's not, it was challenging to me. One of the things I love about the Bible is that the Bible can really straighten us up. Even though we think we know it sometimes, the Bible will just take you places you weren't expecting to go. Amen.
Amen.
And I think this morning, if you bear with me for just a few moments, I believe you'll get a mighty word this morning from the Lord. Ephesians chapter 1. We're going to look at verse number 3. We're going to terminate around verse number 14. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who have blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ, according as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world. Let's underline that full phrase, the foundation of the world. That we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestinated us to the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise and glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us accepted in the beloved, whom we have redemption through his blood, forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace, wherein he hath abound toward us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known unto us the mystery of his will, according to the good pleasure which he hath purposed in himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in him, in whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will. We should be to the praise of his glory, who first trusted in Christ, in whom you also trusted. After that, you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, after that, you believed, you were sealed. Underline the phrase, you were sealed. Sealed with the Holy Spirit promise, which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption, purchased possession unto the praise of his glory. Brothers and sisters, for a few moments, I want to speak from this topic, an expose of the gospel. An expose of the gospel. And for a subtitle, I would like to call this The Godhead's Plan. The Godhead's Plan. Paul, the writer of this beautiful letter, teaches us about a wonderful truth. He explains by way of divine inspiration the mind of God as it pertains to the gospel of Jesus Christ. As we explore part one of this great chapter, I believe it will give us an exciting new perspective on an old-time gospel. The Church of Ephesus was a church in a city made famous by the seventh wonder of the world, the Temple of Diana. This temple could hold 50,000 patrons. It was in this city Priscilla and Aquila started the church. In Acts chapter 18 and verse number 6, it was in this city Paul personally ministered for 3 years in Acts chapter 19. It was in this city Paul then placed Timothy to be a ministering evangelist to those at Ephesus in 1 Timothy chapter 1 verse 3. And it was the same loveless church mentioned later by the Apostle John in AD 95, Revelation chapter 2. We are going to examine this morning the Godhead's perspective in our redemptive process. This morning, we're again going to talk about an expose of the gospel, the Godhead's plan. And if you bear with me, you're going to see something that I think most of us have really rarely seen taught, and that is salvation from God's perspective. Now, when I say God's perspective, I want you to understand there's really two perspectives one can have when it comes to salvation. We can have, and what we teach mostly, is a man up to God perspective. That is what man must do. Man must be obedient. Man must have faith. All of this is true. But Paul also writes this letter, and he's going to show us a top-down perspective of salvation. When I say top down, I mean God is looking down at us, and he's going to show us salvation through his eyes. Now, I want to warn you, you're going to have to keep notes this morning. This is not a feel-good, a warming type of, I can get a couple of points and take it home. You really need to take notes, because if you're not careful, some of the things I will be speaking about may even sound heretical. And it's only because you may not have heard this before. But I want to challenge you this morning, because we all need to have our theology challenged from time to time. First of all, brothers and sisters, I'm going to show you the gospel from the Father, from the Son, and from the Holy Spirit. I'm going to show you. It's in the book. I'm going to show you the gospel from the perspective of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. First of all, Paul gives a salutation in verse 1 and 2. But then he says in verse 3, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who have blessed us with all spiritual blessings." Brothers and sisters, I want you to notice that God is the central point of every pneumatikos blessing. Word pneumatical simply means spiritual. And when we say spiritual, that really points to the fact that it has to come from the Holy Spirit. Anything you read, spiritually speaking, in the Bible, it has been given to us from a supernatural source. In other words, what we're going to read is something that is not man-generated, it is God-generated. So first and foremost, I want you to understand that, because that's the foundation of what Paul is writing here. Then the Bible tells us that the spiritual blessings are in heavenly places. These places are not now carnal, they're not earthly, they're not sensuous. They come from heaven. Verse 4 says, "According as he hath chosen us." And brothers and sisters, understand this. God has the right to choose. That word there, choose, is a compound of the Greek. It is a word called ekklesia or ekklesia. And it comes from the preposition ek, which means out of. Then the word lego literally means, it means to determine or to choose. And so what God has done is he has chosen out of the world. How did he do that, God? Well, I want you to see. He has chosen us in him. The Spirit is within the scope of God. Think of it as a circle. And God has chosen all who are going to be saved in the Spirit of God. Now, preacher, what do you mean by the Spirit of God? I thought you said God chose. He did, but he chooses a spirit. Not an individual, but a spirit. So when you think of salvation from God's perspective, understand God has chosen, but he chooses from a spirit. And if you are not within
sphere, then you are not considered the chosen. Paul writes this letter not to unsaved people, but he writes this to the church at Ephesus. Why is that important? It's important because he is not writing to non-believers. Everybody who he's speaking to is saved. And so what Paul is saying is, everybody is under the same scope. You are the called out. Now, brothers and sisters, as we look at this further, I want you to understand, an election does not simply mean I've chosen some to be saved and some to go to hell. Because the word election, in the way Paul uses it, is simply saying God has called some, or he's called all, but there are some who decide to obey the calling. The calling goes out to the world, and those who respond are those who appropriate the calling will then be placed in the sphere of Christ. That's the Father's part. Are you with me thus far?
Yes.
But then I want you to see this. The Bible says in verse 4, he has chosen us in him, that's the sphere, before the foundation of the world. Now, what does that mean, before the foundation of the world? God made this election and it had nothing to do with us. Oh, preacher, you're sounding like your false teacher now. And that doesn't sound right. I want you to understand, God made a choice and it was before the foundation of the world. Again, we're not looking at salvation from man to God, we're looking at salvation from God to man. This is God's foreknowledge. God knows things beforehand. Now, preacher, I want you to justify that for me. Run over to Revelation chapter 13, verse number 8. Revelation chapter 13, verse number 8. And I want us to see the same phrase used in relationship to Jesus Christ. If someone has it down front, just read that for me. Revelation 13, verse 8. What does the Bible say?
All who dwell on the earth will worship him, whose names have not been written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world.
Stop right there. The Bible describes Christ as the Lamb. He is the Lamb of God, the spotless Lamb of God. But I want you to notice something else. The Bible says he was slain from the foundation of the world. Now, when the Lord said, let there be light, Jesus incarnate was not crucified. During the time of Adam and Eve, Jesus the Christ was not crucified. During the time of Noah, Moses, Zechariah, Jeremiah, Isaiah, Habakkuk, Nahum, Jesus the Christ was not sacrificed or crucified. But God understood in his foreknowledge that there would come a time when Jesus Christ would die for the sins of the world. And so in God's mind, God can say he was slain from the foundation of the world. Now, did he make the man kill Jesus? No, no. He didn't make the Jews talk bad about the Lord. He didn't make the Romans put Jesus up on the cross. But what he knew was that he had a situation where down the stream of time, Jesus would come to earth and man would reject him, and thus they would crucify him for sins he never committed. All right. So God can say he was crucified from the foundation of the world. Are you with me thus far?
Amen.
It gets deep, brothers and sisters. Now I want you to see something else in that verse. It says that we should be holy and without blame before him. God understands that you and I will never be sinless. So what does he have to do? He has to create a plan that will have you and I in a sinless Jesus. You and I have to be in Christ in order for us not to be condemned by the sins that we have committed.
Amen.
That's God's plan. Remember, we're looking at God's perspective of salvation, not man's. I'm going to get to man, so just hold on. I know in your mind you're already ready there, but I want you to see it from God's perspective this morning. Big brothers and sisters, I want you to look at something else. He says in verse 5, having predestinated, you see that? Having predestinated us until the adoption of children by Jesus Christ. Now he uses the term here, in the original, predestinated. It's a word that causes controversy. It's caused controversy among scholars for hundreds, if not thousands of years. What does it mean to be predestinated? What does God mean when he says, I have chosen some? And what does it mean that he has called you? Over there in John chapter 15, verse 16, he told the disciples, he said, you have not chosen me, I have chosen you. What does he mean by predestination? What does it mean to be predestined? It is in what they call the aorist tense, and the middle voice, and the indicative mood. It simply suggests that God has done this thing prior to. It's in past tense. In other words, he's done it already. And the middle voice indicates that it's a reflexive. In other words, he's done it for his own benefit. And the indicative mood simply means that it's a statement of fact or reality. Now, Lord, how have you predestinated us? The word predestinate comes from the Greek term proorizo. Proorizo. It's a compound term. The prefix pro means before. And the suffix horizo, where we get the word horizon from, it literally means to mark out. So God has before marked out. He's marked out what? A plan. Not a people, but a plan and a people that are in the plan. So if you are not in the plan that God has pre-planned, then you will not be his people and thus you will not be chosen. Are you with me thus far?
Amen.
I told you, you got to keep notes this morning.
Amen.
Like Muhammad Ali, you got to keep the camera on me. I'm kind of quick.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. It's a lot of information, I know, but I want you to understand this because it's important. You will have friends who are not members of the Lord's church. They will ask you questions. They will say, well, how is this? How do you believe this? Well, I believe that. And you have to be able to articulate this position. So brothers and sisters, stay with me if you will. Now I want you to see something else in verse number 5. He says, having predestinated us unto the adoption. Underline the word adoption. He says the adoption of children by Jesus Christ. The word adoption comes from a word, and we think we're familiar with it, but in the Roman usage of that term, adoption was a very common thing. When the wealthy did not have a male child, what they would do is they would look for a servant or a slave who had a male child. They would adopt that child so their name could go on. One of the most famous adoptions in Roman history was when Julius Caesar adopted a young man by the name of Octavius. And so he became his son, not through birth, but through adoption. And then when Julius Caesar was no longer Caesar, his son Octavius became Caesar. Because whatever rights were held by the father, once the father died, he transferred those rights to his son. Ah, I'm getting good. I'm getting good. When you're an adopted child in the Roman era, in the Roman milieu, it literally meant that everything the natural born child had, you had. Every single right that the natural born child had, you had. You were not a stepchild. You were just as solid, if you will, as the natural born child.
Amen.
In other words, if the father was a millionaire, he would will you his millions. And what does Jesus or Paul say here? Paul says, we, those who were once estranged, who were once afar off, who are not part of the commonwealth of Israel, we are now adopted as children of God. Now you should have just stood up and shouted right there.
Amen.
See, it didn't strike you because see, you're not really feeling this. I said you have been adopted by God. And you are now a child of his through belief.
Amen.
And God did it. You didn't do a thing. You're going to have to do something, but you haven't done a thing yet. Watch this. And then he says, according, and this is so beautiful, he says, according to his good pleasure, There's another translation, I believe it's the New American Standard Version, that says, according to his kind affection. The word according there simply means it comes from God and not from you. It was God's kind affection that said, I want you to be my child. Not because you are so good, not because you crossed every T and dotted every I. Not because you were so pretty and so clean this morning. Not because you live over in the north side and not the south side. Not because your skin tone is lighter or darker than somebody. Not because of anything outwardly that you have done. I want to adopt you as my child.
Amen.
Because it's in my pleasure. It's my good pleasure. It's my thelema. It is my desire that you become my child. And I'm not going to use any superficial standard to say, if you meet this, then you got it. Because in the Old Testament, they had to meet a standard. If you didn't reach the bar, you were considered condemned. And you could have been killed physically for not doing what God said. God still has a standard. But now he has given us grace to go with the standard. So when I'm weak, I'm strong in Christ. When I mess up, I don't have to avoid coming to church anymore. When I have a child out of wedlock, yes, I may have messed up, but you did too one day. And we are all just sinners saved by God's grace. Not by works of men, lest any man should boast. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. God understood you're going to need help. As bad as you are. And let me tell you something else about adoption. Usually, when you adopt a child, the adopted child doesn't even look like you. I said, when you adopt a child, the adopted child normally doesn't look like you. The Lord says, I'm going to adopt you, even though you don't even look like me. I'm holy, and you're far from holy. I'm clean, and you mighty dirty. I'm strong, and you simply are weak. But even though you're not like me, I want you to be my child. God, this is good, y'all. This is good. The Bible says in verse 6, to the praise of his glory, of his grace. And I want you to understand, I'm going to add the word grace there. The Lord says something in this phrase that's very beautiful. The word grace there is a Greek term called charitapo. Charitapo. You hear the word charity, don't you? The Lord says it is according to his grace. And that word charitapo is different from the word charis. That's a cognate of the word charis. Charitapo is a cognate of charis. It literally means grace, but this thing is a grace that pursues. In other words, God loved you so much, he is pursuing you with his grace. He's going after you. While you're walking away from him, he's saying, but my grace, I want to give it to you. I got grace. Come back. God loved you so much, your evil mind stinking self, and God said, but my grace is going to get you. I want to send my grace to you so bad. It's going to hunt you now. That's how much God loves you. Then the Bible goes on to say, wherein he had made us, watch this, accepted in the blood. If his grace letting you down doesn't make you shout, maybe this week. God not only sends out his grace, but he made you something. Now, the word made implies that you weren't something before. Oh, yeah, I'm not with me this morning. I wish I had a church. Now, y'all sitting there like, oh, ain't nothing special. I knew that already. I tell you, God has made you something that you were not already.
All right. Amen.
When you become a child of God, when you are baptized in the remission of your sin, God makes you something that you weren't.
Amen.
You know, I saw a picture of, her name is Riri, right? Rihanna, I believe that's her name. Called Riri. And they had a picture of her, a picture when she wasn't famous. And, you know, hair was sticking up. And then they had a picture of her when she was, you know, famous. And she got her hair gone, her eyes look good, makeup is nice. And they said sometimes, this is what the meme said, don't quote this scripture. He said sometimes, it's not that you're ugly, it's just that you're broke. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Sometimes it's not that you're ugly, it's just that you don't have no money to do yourself up, baby.
Amen.
What the Lord did was, he said, you were ugly before I met you, but I done made you up. You don't realize what you look like to God. Your sins made you ugly to God. But now God says, I have made you accepted. And watch this, where you accepted? In the spirit of the beloved.
Amen.
When I clean you up, I'm not going to leave you outside. I'm going to put you in. But watch this, where are you going to put me in? Because that's the preposition of location. You didn't know that. He says, I'm going to put you accepted in the beloved. Who is the beloved? Jesus Christ.
Amen.
That's who loves you, brothers and sisters. And so we have seen so far the Father. Okay, now can I show you the Son? Watch the Son here, verse 7. In whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of whose grace? Your grace?
His grace.
Brothers and sisters, we have redemption. That word redemption is a powerful word. It literally means a ransom. God has paid the price for you. You were a slave at one point, and you were in sin, and the devil had you, and he drug you. He said, you want to go to the party? You said,